The Islamic State just murdered a Chinese citizen. Did they just wake the sleeping dragon? It's November 19th. You're watching The Ezra Levant Show.
Why should others go to jail when you're a biggest carbon consumer I know?
There's 8,500 customers here, and you won't give them an answer.
You come here once a year with a sign, and you feel morally superior.
The only thing I have to say to the government about why I publish it is because it's my bloody right to do so.
I've got a question for you. How does China fight against Muslim terrorists? We see how other great powers are dealing with it. Obama has retreated from the Middle East, creating a void that's being filled by terrorist groups like the Islamic State and by Iran. The U.S. has only a token military force left in the region. France has said it would wage a pitiless war against the Islamic State, but in the days after the Paris terrorist attacks, they dropped just 20 bombs, not 2,020. Under Justin Trudeau, Canada, once so mighty that we had our own landing beach at Normandy called Juno Beach, well, Trudeau's announced that we will withdraw our six CF-18 jets from the anti-Islamic State coalition. We're not going to fight at all. In other words, the West is failing. Russia seems more serious. This year, they brought in a serious military force to Syria. Fighters, bombers, attack helicopters. They have a naval base in Syria, their only one on foreign soil. They're also launching cruise missiles against targets from longer distances. As an amateur observer, it seems clear to me that Putin's goal is to actually seriously damage terrorists, including the Islamic State, not just to do the minimum necessary for public opinion. And Putin's statement this week that the Russian jetliner that crashed over Egypt was brought down by a terrorist bomb, that statement suggests that he's about to ramp up his military campaign even further. But back to my question, what about China? China has no military bases around the world, but they're starting to reach beyond their own shores. More than 30 Chinese warships have been deployed in anti-piracy missions in the Middle East over the past 10 years. They also evacuated Chinese nationals from Libya and Yemen. China has a Muslim population. I've seen stats ranging from 25 million to 50 million people. In an officially atheist society, it's tough to count. They're concentrated in the West, including in Xinjiang province, where the ethnic Uyghurs are Muslim. China regularly calls Uyghurs, quote, Muslim terrorists, but it's hard to know if that's just China using Western PR-friendly language to cover up the fact that the Uyghurs, like Tibetans and other ethnic minorities, just don't like being under China's thumb. I've been to Xinjiang myself, and it struck me as a fairly easygoing place. I saw no niqabs or burqas my whole time there. It seemed like a more ancient live and let live form of Islam that hadn't yet been infected by either Saudi or Iranian money and radicalism. But look at this. Here's a story from Radio Free Asia. That's a democracy-oriented news agency. China's state-controlled press was boasting of an anti-terror raid in Xinjiang province that killed 17 suspects, including women and children. The raid was in response to what Beijing called a terrorist attack earlier this fall that killed 50 people at a coal mine. In that coal mine attack, knife-wielding terrorists killed security guards at a coal mine and then targeted the owner's home and a dormitory for workers. China state-run media has meticulously covered the terrorist attacks in Paris, too. China has declared a crackdown on what they call the three evils in Xinjiang: terrorism, separatism, and religious extremism. And as this news this last week shows, Chinese government is no longer shy about publishing their own brutal counter-terrorism raids, even when they killed children. So here's my question. How much of China's talk of counter-terrorism is just a smokescreen for their normal anti-democracy, anti-dissent violence, as in communist Chinese secret police just doing what they've always done? And how much of it is really anti-jihad work, stopping Xinjiang Muslims from being radicalized and fighting back at the Islamic State, perhaps? Well, I think we're about to find out, because the Islamic State just announced that it killed its first Chinese victim, 50-year-old Fan Jinghui. He was murdered by the Islamic State terrorist group, and they bragged about it in their terrorist magazine, Dabiq. Murdering a Chinese citizen and bragging about it is a pretty momentous thing to do for the Islamic State. They do that all the time with Western terrorists, but the West barely shrugs anymore. But China? It's not just that China lacks the political correctness of the West, and it's not just the traditional Chinese concept of saving face and losing face. It's that China is a dictatorship that rules over dozens of different ethnic groups, many of which would rather be autonomous. So China, as a dictatorship, can't let the precedent be set that a religious terrorist group can kill a Chinese citizen and brag about it and then get a free pass. I mean, the West doesn't care about itself anymore. And obviously, a Chinese dictator doesn't actually care about an individual Chinese citizen, but the Chinese dictator knows that his grip on the other 1.2 billion or so Chinese citizens depends on how he handles this challenge. So today, at the APEC summit in the Philippines, no one less than the Chinese president himself, Xi Jinping, addressed the murder of the Chinese citizen. He didn't have some press secretary do it for him. He did it himself. Quote, China strongly condemns the brutal murder of a Chinese national by Islamic State. I express my deep condolences to the families of the victim. Terrorism is the common enemy of humanity. China resolutely opposes terrorism in any form and resolutely fights against violent terrorist criminal activities that challenge the bottom line of human civilization, unquote. So what does that mean? China has one aircraft carrier, and it's probably not operationally ready to sail for Syria. China has long-range missiles, but it's unlikely to shoot them all the way over a dozen countries to get to their targets. So what can China do? What will China do? Maybe it will send soldiers. Will China provide the ground troops to work with Putin's air force in Syria? Will China simply take out its rage against Uyghur nationalists in Xinjiang province? I don't know. But given President Xi's public statements, I get the feeling we're about to find out. You know, Napoleon said, China is a sleeping giant. Let her sleep, for when she wakes, she will move the world. 200 years later, we might be about to find out what that means. Stay with us for more after these messages.
Looking for the perfect gift? Did you know TheRebel.media has a store? Make a statement with a t-shirt. Have your morning coffee in a Fearless Travel coffee mug. There's even an Ezra Levant bobblehead. It's a one-stop shop for the perfect gift. And don't forget to pick up something for yourself. Go to TheRebel.media/store to find out more.
Welcome back. The other night we showed you some video footage from when I went into Muslim neighborhoods in Paris just days after the massive terrorist attacks on that city, and I asked very basic questions of anyone who would speak with me. Since then we've had time to translate and caption even more video footage, and I'd like to show you that now and give you my comments. Now let me admit in advance that my French is terrible, my vocabulary is limited, my grammar is atrocious, my accent is awful, but that doesn't matter. I was able to understand the men and ask them basic questions. What's important is what the men I spoke with had to say to me. And that's the thing, it was actually all men. We occasionally saw Muslim women hurrying to market to buy something and then get back home. But on the streets, and especially just lounging around in the restaurants and kebab stands, it was literally 100% men. I don't think I saw a single woman just lounging about, as opposed to downtown white Paris, a city of beautiful girls freely walking or bicycling around the city or sipping espressos on a patio. Anyways, here are several clips, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I'll give you my brief thoughts after each one, and then I'll talk with Marc Lebuis, the director of the Pointe de Bascule website that specializes in radical Islam. Here, let's roll the first clip now.
President Hollande a dit c'est une guerre contre qui?
Contre le terrorisme.
Daesh et terroriste. Pourquoi?
C'est une idéologie.
Qui va gagner la guerre s'il est une guerre?
Je sais pas comment on peut définir cette guerre parce que c'est international, c'est pas un ennemi fixe. Ils sont partout. C'est dur de gagner une guerre comme ça, c'est pas facile. Parce que nous avons un ennemi objectif, il est là-bas, on sait qu'il est là-bas. Mais là, c'est international, donc c'est plus que les armes. Il faut sortir, plus que les armes, plus que tout, quoi. Il faut sentir l'intelligence, il faut discuter, il faut le dialogue, il faut plein de choses.
That guy was the owner of a Turkish restaurant. He seemed fairly normal, fairly moderate. I didn't plumb his views on things like Jews or Israel, but that wasn't really important. He seemed to want to be a Frenchman living in peace. But let me show you the next clip. Take a look.
Il y a des bandits, c'est tout. C'est pas un côté radical, un côté musulman. C'est des bandits.
Ah, okay.
Voilà, on peut pas dire ça un groupe. C'est pas un groupe. C'est des bandits, c'est tout. Qui mettent la pagaille. C'est pas un groupe radical et un groupe islam modéré. Non, l'islam, c'est l'islam.
Il faut pas changer, mélanger. Voilà.
On peut pas définir ça comme deux groupes musulmans. Il faut pas voir ça comme ça. Daesh exerce plutôt dans les pays musulmans. Il fait des attentats dans les pays extérieurs, ok, mais il tue plus de musulmans que de chrétiens ou de juifs ou d'autres religions. Donc c'est toujours les musulmans qui sont pris par cible. C'est des centaines de musulmans qui sont morts tous les jours en Syrie.
I'm of two views with what he said there. On the one hand, I guess there's an absence of total insanity. There's a realization that the Islamic State kills, that it's evil, that other Muslims and Christians are killed too, even if Muslims are the primary targets. But you can see the appeal of setting up a rule that he did. If they're terrorists, they cannot be Muslim. Call them bandits or whatever, and I'm glad he did. That shows that he has a humanity to him, that he feels French in terms of denouncing them. But he has decided in advance that they cannot be Muslim, the terrorists, even if they say they are Muslim, because that would force him to deal with a problem in his own faith, and he does not want to. Next clip.
C'est terrorisme, c'est...
C'est terrorisme, c'est pas les musulmans qui font ça.
C'est pas les musulmans...
Parce qu'il y a beaucoup de... Il y a des Tunisiens, il y a des Algériens qui meurent. Chez nous, en Paris, tout ce que c'est, le peuple sont à l'aise, sont ensemble.
Qui a fait ça?
C'est un terrorisme.
Daesh?
Je sais pas, Daesh, je sais pas.
J'ai écouté les autres jeunes musulmans a dit que les États-Unis font ça.
Je sais pas, parce que ça sont des actes de politique.
Les attentats sont les actes politiques?
Oui, c'est des actes de politique. Bah, j'ai d'autres des actes de juifs, je sais pas. Parce que j'ai assez assouvi des juifs. C'est pas les musulmans.
Peut-être les juifs a fait ça?
Peut-être les juifs. Mais les musulmans, c'est, non. Pour moi, non. Les musulmans, ils ne font pas ça. Là.
Le président de France, François Hollande, a dit que France est à la guerre. Contre qui?
La guerre contre le terrorisme.
Dirigisme?
Parce que le terrorisme...
Dirigisme islamiste ou dirigisme général?
Le terrorisme général. Le terrorisme parce que le terrorisme, c'est pas musulman.
So again, by definition, terrorism can't be Muslim. Just can't be. Like saying fire can't be wet. It's just impossible, so don't even contemplate it. In fact, he points out, as the earlier guy in the Turkish restaurant did, that Muslims are the victims. No, 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 they're not the perpetrators. They are the victims, too. And note how he points out that President Hollande says it wasn't Muslim, so there's your proof. Here, take a look at the next clip.
C'est pas musulman, c'est qui? Les terrorismes chrétiens? Les terrorismes juifs?
Parce que François Hollande, il est interrompu. Le musulman, c'est pas fait ça. Le terrorisme, c'est pas musulman, c'est pas vrai musulman. Les musulmans ne font pas ça.
Est-ce que Daesh est musulman?
Non, Daesh pour moi c'est juif.
Daesh est juif?
Une organisation juive.
Daesh est une organisation juive, comment?
Suivi à l'américaine.
Vous êtes sérieux? Qui a dit ça à vous?
Pour moi, j'ai vu, je comprends. Parce que...
Vous avez lire ça dans l'Internet? Ou qui a dit à vous que Daesh est un organisme juif?
Ah, c'est les malins des juifs. Ah, oui, c'est malins des juifs, des Américains, pour entrer en Syrie, entrer en l'Irak, entrer pour ramener les pétroles.
Blame Americans or Jews, the great Satan or the little Satan. Any scapegoat will do. America's in Syria and Iraq for the oil, don't you know? But look at that. He looks so modern. He looks so French. He wasn't wearing a big Islamic beard or not dressed in an abaya. He looked like a hipster as well as he could. But not only does he think that the Islamic State, that they call it Daesh over there, the Islamic State is not Islamic, that it's actually a Jewish ruse, a Jewish trick, an American trick to blame Muslims and to grab the oil. This is something I heard probably half a dozen times, and I started to ask other Muslims I met, do you think that the Jews did it? Or just, I wouldn't put that in their mind. I would just say, who do you think did it? And the Jews popped up as an answer. Half the Muslims I spoke with, here, take a look at the next clip.
Votre ami aussi croit que Daesh est une organisation juive? Can I ask you guys? Merci. No? You guys want to talk a little bit on... Votre ami a dit à moi que Daesh est une organisation créée par les Juifs. C'est vrai?
C'est vrai, oui.
Come on!
Les Juifs, t'es raciste, les Juifs.
Vous êtes sérieuse?
Oui, sérieuse, oui.
Non, c'est pas.
Qui a dit ça à vous? Vous lirez à Internet, vous écoutez ça par un imam. Qui a dit que...
Parce que les musulmans ne font pas ça.
Les musulmans ne font pas ça.
Les juifs qui sont entrés à Palestine, entrés comment on a dit, à la frontière de Syrie.
Vous avez dit dire que les musulmans ne font pas ça. Vous ne...
Toujours à Gaza, les morts regardent la TV, Palestine, Syrie. Toujours on a tiré, je ne sais pas.
À quel pays...
Seulement les morts, toujours. Regarde l'Afrique, toujours.
Toujours les musulmans...
Toujours
les victimes sont musulmanes.
À Bataclan, les victimes...
Tunisiens, victimes de Tunisiens, Algériens.
Mais aussi les chrétiens, les juifs.
Ici en Paris, c'est pas musulman.
Une question finale. World Trade Center 9/11, c'est aussi les terroristes ou aussi les juifs ou les États-Unis?
Les États-Unis. L'organisation des Daesh, c'est une organisation qui suit juifs et américains, États-Unis.
I thought they were joking. I thought they were kidding, putting me on. They were not. They believed this. I mean, it's one thing to be in denial about Muslim terrorism. I understand that as a coping mechanism. If you're Muslim, you simply don't want to, you want to dissociate yourself from the terrorists and say they can't be me. But it's another thing to blame others, the Jews. Now, blaming the Jews and denying that Muslims are terrorists, that's not terrorism itself. Those young men are not terrorists, as far as I know. But their ideas enable terrorism. But there are hints of other things. Jews as a sickness, Jews as a cancer, as a malade, Jews and Americans as devious, secret controllers of power and influence and lies. Could you build a country with 10 million people like this? Would people like this respect state authority? Would they turn in Muslim radicals to the police for plotting a terrorist attack? Would they respect Jews, women, other minorities? Can you build a modern secular society, separation of mosque and state, with men and women like that as the bricks? Here, take a look at this next clip.
J'ai discuté avec autre jeune musulman de Paris et il a dit à moi, pardon mon français, excusez-moi, il a dit à moi que Daesh est créé par les Juifs et les Américains. Cet attentat created or made? Créé par les Juifs ou les Américains.
C'est théorie complot. Ça, c'est les théories complot.
On ne peut pas savoir ce genre de choses. Ça, c'est des gens, ils sont fous. C'est des psychopathes.
C'est une. Un message.
Un message de quoi? Un message. C'est quoi comme message? Qu'est-ce qu'ils veulent passer comme message?
Les autres jeunes musulmans, dites à moi que. Est impossible cet attentat des musulmans parce que les musulmans jamais faire le terrorisme.
Ça n'a rien à voir avec les musulmans. C'est musulmans Daesh, deux choses différentes. C'est pas pareil.
Qu'est-ce que vous allez faire contre Daesh ou le terrorisme? Et vous, et vous, et vous, et vous, et vous, avez-vous une responsabilité de combattre contre?
Il ne faut pas être responsable des bêtises des gens. Demandez à vous, par exemple, un compatriote à vous qui va faire une bêtise.
Mais
on va pas dire que c'est vous, on va pas mélanger la chose. C'est chaque personne est responsable de ses actes. Faut pas mettre tout le monde dans le même sac. Mais pourquoi on fait des généralités? Daesh est des terroristes.
À votre nom. Et alors, fait ça à votre nom.
Le Ku Klux Klan, au nom du christianisme, il tuait des noirs.
Et
est-ce que pour autant on disait que les chrétiens étaient des terroristes? Il faut pas mélanger les musulmans et les terroristes. Faut pas, c'est deux choses qui sont totalement différentes.
Avez-vous téléphoné à radio et dit ce n'est pas un acte islamiste? Avez-vous faire anything?
Sur les réseaux sociaux, oui.
On dira tous, nous on est contre le Daesh.
On n'a jamais été pour la violence. Nous, l'islam, elle a jamais écrit.
In a way, that was encouraging. They dismissed as conspiracy theories the idea that the Islamic State is a Jewish or an American creation. But they renounce also that the Islamic State is Islamic. They just simply refuse to believe it. They call it Daesh. They say they publicly denounced and renounced Daesh. I'm skeptical that they did so, but I'm glad to hear at least their claim to have done so. Let me show you another clip from these young men. Take a look.
Vous êtes net en France aussi?
Oui, je suis.
Et votre famille?
Ma famille est née dans le pays d'origine, mais c'est pas pour autant que on est.
À votre que vous êtes un Français prioritaire 1?
Oui, je suis français, j'ai grandi en France, j'ai eu une éducation à la française, sans pour autant mettre mes origines de côté, parce que je suis quelqu'un qui est ouvert, mais c'est pas pour autant que on est des terroristes. Il faut pas mélanger les choses. Bien sûr qu'on a une haine à Daesh. Regardez l'image qu'il comporte, tout le monde croit qu'on est tous des terroristes.
Musulmans à Paris dit que
moi, tous les.
J'ai haine à Daesh.
Personne n'adhère à Daesh. Il n'y a personne que je connais dans mon entourage qui adhère à Daesh. Au contraire. Nous, vous ramenez Daesh ici, ou on va leur faire la même chose qu'ils font aux gens.
Vous écoutez une autre musulman à dire j'aime le Daesh. Vous dites quoi?
Qu'est-ce que je lui dirais? Je lui dirais qu'il se trompe de route et puis je lui expliquerai qu'il me montre des preuves de ce que Daesh est en train de faire et où il a lu ce qu'il prône. Parce que dans l'islam, il n'y a jamais écrit ça. On lit le Coran, il n'y a jamais écrit ça.
On n'a pas le même islam. On n'a pas le même islam. C'est pas la même chose.
C'est pas l'islam qu'ils font, c'est des psychopathes ces gens-là. C'est des psychopathes, faut les traiter comme des psychopathes. C'est pas des musulmans. Moi, les musulmans, ça n'existe pas, ça. Faut tuer des gens. On tue pas les faibles, ça va pas. Faut jamais faire ça. C'est interdit dans l'islam de tuer son prochain déjà.
There are some encouraging things here. He thinks of himself as a Frenchman first. He's open to all sorts of people. He says he would condemn anyone in his circle who supports the Islamic State. I believe him on that. I believe him. But it's also scary to know that someone born in France, educated in a French secular school, as French legally, on paper, as French historically, as François Hollande himself, would still say that there is no connection to terrorism and radical Islam. I think that he's in denial, but frankly, he's in no further or deeper denial than the white leftists I met downtown. Let me show you one more clip from a chauffeur of a Uber cab we were in. We took Ubers a lot around Paris, and 90% of the drivers are Muslim, so we struck up conversations. Let me show you one quick clip because there's something interesting in it. Take a look.
Ça confirme que c'est pas des musulmans, que c'est pas l'islam.
Combien musulmans?
Pas du tout.
Pas du tout.
Combien musulmans en France?
Un petit peu.
Hein?
Un petit peu.
Combien
eux prennent la drogue pour faire ça, eux, ils utilisent la drogue pour être motivés. C'est la preuve que c'est pas la foi qui pousse à ça.
I enjoyed that cab driver. We drove past a homeless man, and he just slowed down, stopped, and gave him money. Clearly a pious man, a generous man, a man who told me he prays five times a day. He's trying to be a good Muslim and a good Frenchman. But do you see the lengths he went? He said these Muslim terrorists could not have been Muslim because, he says, they were hopped up on drugs to commit their terrorism, and that could well be true. But anything to avoid realizing that the Islamic State, while not representative of all Muslims, is representative as of some. That its leader, of course, is a PhD in Islamic theology, that they have imams and they cite the Quran as their source of legitimate authority. It seems like too much for both Muslim Frenchmen and non-Muslims to process that this terrorism could be coming from the Quran. I don't know what to make of all of this. We visited as many Muslim people as we could. We tried to find them. And this wasn't even in the banlieues. This wasn't even in the deep suburbs or the housing projects far from the city. This was 20 minutes from our hotel downtown. This was all within the Ring Road. These were all modern-looking people interacting with white French folks every day, with multicultural French folks every day. These weren't folks with long beards and studying the Quran all day. I can only imagine the depths of denial or conspiracy theories in some of those parts. And here's the question. How do you build a modern liberal society when you have 5-10 million people who deny that terrorism is motivated by Islam, and some of whom, let's say half the ones I saw, have troubling views about the West, about Jews, about trusting even any institution of authority in the West? How do you build a society based on that? How do you wage a war against terrorism when it's an idea that's taken root in your own country? These are troubling questions. So after the break, I'll be joined by my friend Marc Lebuis of Pointe de Bascule, who hopefully can help me answer them. Stay with us for that.
We've heard you loud and clear. You can't get enough Canadian conservative news and opinion. Why not check out our blog? It's all your favorite conservative bloggers together on a page called The Megaphone. Go to therebel.media/themegaphone or click on the Megaphone menu from our main page to check it out.
Well, what do you make of that? To me, that was the highlight of my trip to Paris, getting out of the downtown core where the white liberals were and going out into the Muslim neighborhoods. I should tell you, we never actually went far. It was 20 minutes from our hotel. It was still in Paris proper within the Ring Road. If we had gone further out into the banlieues where there are housing projects, some of them majority Muslim, I think we would have had even more radical views. But this was actually in the city. Well, joining me now to help digest what we've just seen is my friend Marc Lebuis. He's the director of Pointe de Bascule, a research website documenting radical Islam. And it was Marc and his team that helped us translate and make the captions that you saw on those screens. And Marc joins me now from Quebec via Skype. Marc, great to see you again. And thank you for your help translating all that French.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
Well, I thought that talking to real French Muslims, and I don't mean official spokesmen for this Muslim lobby group or that Muslim lobby group, but just going out on the street and saying, excuse moi, monsieur, can I ask you some questions? We didn't talk to hundreds of people, but between the cab drivers and the people on the street, I think we spoke with at least a dozen different Muslims. What was your general impression of what you saw, Marc?
Well, it almost seems as if they all receive the same guidelines and the same narrative. Deny any link that the Islamic State, ISIS or ISIL, is linked to or there might be Muslims. So right off the bat, there's always this first denial that comes up. So that was pretty clear, and the message is always the same. And then afterward, what I was noticing is they had a lot of trouble articulating the way that they can distance themselves from the reality of the Islamic State. And I guess the French in general have capitulated by adopting the term Daesh, which is a term that the OIC has enforced on many countries to be able to say that, you know, the Islamic State is not Islamic. Here's the words that we're suggesting to the media. Why don't you use Daesh instead?
You're right, they all call it Daesh there. If you would have said Etat Islamique, they would have sort of understood, but they all say Daesh, the Muslims and the old stock white French. That's the weirdest part to me, Marc. Both the Muslims in the neighborhoods and the white leftists downtown all agree this terrorism wasn't Muslim. So it's not just the young Muslims I spoke with who were all on the same page. It's the official French establishment. And one of these Muslim kids said to me, President Hollande himself said it wasn't Muslim. So there you have it. Almost like he was throwing that in my face as the ultimate proof. If our white French president says it's not Muslim, there you have it.
The power may be a fear. They've already had, just last year, about it, at this time, they started a whole series of terrorist attacks in France that were barely covered in the media, but that was before Charlie Hebdo, you know, around Christmas time, these people driving cars and hitting people. And it just gets stronger and bigger in France specifically.
So these were not the hardcore looking, like they looked young and modern and integrated. Those ones were obviously born abroad, but later, the ones I spoke to later out in front of the convenience store, many of them were born in France. So these aren't radicals who have just come over from Syria. Or some of them maybe, but even the ones born in France and who look modern, they harbor either conspiracy theories or resentments, or I don't. It's terrifying to me that they are as French as could be.
Well, they're French in terms of their passport. They're French, maybe technically speaking.
Well, that's what I mean. They're legally French, like born in France, educated in France. Oh, yeah, I mean, their values are not French. Sorry, I was too vague there. Their values are not French. Their beliefs are not French. Their information is not French. Their outlook is not French. But on paper, they are as French as Charles de Gaulle.
And this is why we have to be careful when the media, the mainstream media, are covering the news, and then they say we spoke with people, and some of these perpetrators are French. They say that they're French national. And this is where all the no-go zone comes in, because now they're finally re-talking about this because of the Belgium mastermind. He was in an area that was considered, I think it was the Associated Press, they call it like a very particular area of Brussels. So there's these areas where they're totally isolated. The cops in France, they say that they have about 750 zones of sensitive areas, and about 140 of them are no-go zone, literally no-go zone. But all those 750, these come from French documents. What they need to do is the police department or the fire department, before they go into those areas, they'll have to calculate if they're going to get some police support before they go into these areas. So that means there's an isolation. That means they are safe.
How do you even go about it? One of the questions I asked all these young Muslims was, who's this war against? Because you can send the aircraft carrier to the coast of Syria, as France is doing. But what do you do when the problem is in your own suburbs? Last word to you. Go ahead, Marc.
Well, this is where we're going to have to factor in a lot more the foreign influence into this. We do know that the highest level of government, Hollande, has now opened up a lot more tight ties to Saudi Arabia, and Sarkozy before it was with Qatar. There's a lot of money flowing from these Gulf states, not just to finance mosques, but they're funding industries, they're funding tourism, and most likely Paris tourism is going to be affected by this, because I guess people watching this, they think there's going to be more attacks going on. But the foreign influence is very, very important. So a lot of these politicians could be on the payroll of one of those countries. They could also want to be able to sustain themselves economically. So they want to have these contracts from Saudi Arabia where they're going to purchase all these airplanes. So they have to shut up if there's any problem that's going on in their own country where there's going to have these unacceptable mosques being built and funded and being fed by Wahhabism or very strong Salafism type of Islamic streams. So there's a convergence. That's the fear that right now there's a momentum. There's this conversion. There's all kinds of universities now that are funded by these guys. They're in the neighborhood. They're sending their own preachers in there. They're framing them. Or in French, we say encadré. It's like they're framing them and they're nourishing them. They're reinforcing the belief that they have it, but they're also giving them guidelines like, don't tell these people this, this, and that, because then you're going to alert them. So just tell them that Daesh is not Islam. There's nothing to do. It has nothing to do with Islam, and just deny it.
This issue is only going to get more important. You've done more research on it than anyone else I know. It's great to have you as a friend and an ally. Let's keep in touch on this. And thanks again, and pass on my thanks to your team that helped do the translation for us, okay?
Thank you for having me, and I will pass it on.
Thank you, my friend. Stay with us. My final words after these messages.
So open-minded that the brains have fallen out.
What's the point that you're making?
The point that I'm making is that if you're going to propose a massive overhaul to the way the economy is developed in terms of carbon tax, cap and trade, other forms like that, it helps to have some science that is in fact settled.
Welcome back. Here's your letters to me, or at least a sample of them. Bud Ujla writes, Ezra is way too wordy. You're probably right, Bud, but there's a lot to say, and you can always skip over the boring parts. Alan Swartz writes, Hi, Ezra. After enjoying all your excellent coverage from Paris, I'm happier than ever to have contributed to your new studio. I know I made a wise investment in honest reporting. Alan, that is so nice of you. I appreciate your compliments, and I'm thrilled to hear that you feel like your investment in our studio has been redeemed. Thank you. By the way, later this month, Faith Goldie starts her show, and we're firming up another show. Get this, a live call-in talk show. More on that later. I'm not quite ready to announce the details. Next letter, Greg writes, just writing a quick note of support to you guys to keep up the good work. I realize Saskatchewan is the butt of most of the jokes in Canada, which is okay. We have broad shoulders. Seriously, though, thank you for sending the boys to Paris to show the real story that only you and maybe a couple of other media outlets are willing to be honest about. Thanks for not bowing to the PC police and their daily outrage over whatever might seem honest. We live in a time where honesty is actually mean and intolerant, and it's that mentality that crumbles a society. Thanks for fighting on the right side of history. Thanks, Greg. I mean, Saskatchewan is not the butt of most jokes in Canada. Saskatchewan is the envy of most of Canada. Strongest economy, best premier, great place to live, and a source of a lot of our viewers at The Rebel. So thanks for that. Hey, folks, thank you for joining us today and all week. It's great to be back in Canada after a few days in Paris. I note that the major news networks sent their big guns to Paris, too. CTV sent 10 people, according to one report, along with Lisa LaFlamme. The CBC sent Peter Mansbridge, Anna Maria Tremonti, Adrian Arsenault, Heather Hiscox, David Common, and that's just their on-air talent. And I saw one report that said the CBC spent $100,000 on the trip. I don't believe it. I don't believe for a minute that the CBC spent that little. I don't believe they spent less than $500 a night on hotel rooms for their top talent. Everything first class, government class. I mean, look, the rest of the media is going through massive layoffs, but they're feasting at the CBC. Justin Trudeau just got elected with their help. He's promised them a $150 million a year budget increase. I'm going to guess there were some pretty nice bottles of wine bought at taxpayers' expense by the CBC. We did our shows on a shoestring budget. The most expensive thing were our plane tickets from Toronto. Economy class, bought at the last minute, so they were a little bit pricey. To save money, I even had a roommate at the hotel. I bunked with Gavin McInnes, which was a hoot. We couldn't afford satellite time to send our footage back. It cost about $800 for 15 minutes, so we sent all of our footage back to Canada to be edited here via the internet for free, but it just took a little longer. But I think in a way, with our sliver of a budget, we got more out of our short trip than CTV or CBC got out of theirs. I mean, not personally. Their VIP stars got a lot more out of it personally. I'm sure they went to fancier restaurants than we did, and we were working from 8 a.m. to seriously 3, 4 a.m. But really, what did the CBC do or say from Paris that they couldn't have said or done from Toronto? Nothing. They literally did nothing new by being in Paris as opposed to being in Canada. With our modest budget, we showed you how maudlin and bloodless and the spontaneous protests in the streets of Paris were. They weren't even protests. They were more like festivals. Remember those street performances and the big karaoke sing-alongs of top 40 ballads? So we showed you the sights and sounds that everyone else saw, but we gave you our different opinion. But then we did something that no CBC or CTV journalist would ever even think of doing, or if they thought of it, would ever be allowed to do, even if they spent $1 million. We went into Muslim neighborhoods and asked French Muslims about the place of Islam in France, whether Islam and a democracy could be reconciled, what they had to say about the Islamic State terrorist group. And the reason why the CBC and CTV and the Globe and Mail would never ask those questions is because they are too terrified of the answers. The answers that we showed you a couple days ago and again at length today of young Muslims denying that the Islamic State is Muslim, denying the Muslims can even ever be terrorists. Then some of these young Muslims, deadly serious, insisting that the terrorist attacks last week were just Jewish or American plots to frame Muslims. CTV and CBC would never show you that because it destroys their worldview of multiculturalism, of all religions being peaceful and getting along, of Muslim migrants being assimilable. It's terrifying. There were moderate Muslims indeed. We found proud, patriotic French Muslims who clearly love their country and hate the terrorists and were deeply sad by the attacks. We found them, we showed them to you. We showed them the whole story. But just in our few days of wandering around, I'd say the split was 50-50. And we didn't even go into the hardcore banlieues, the majority Muslim ghettos. Let me know what you think of our first foreign trip. Was it worth it to you? Do you think we should do more of it? It cost us about $6,000, mainly airfare, for 4 days in Paris. Should we do it again if an urgent news item breaks somewhere that you just know the mainstream media is going to spin hard to the left? We wouldn't travel for just anything. I mean, God forbid a tsunami or an earthquake somewhere. Things like that the media probably wouldn't lie about, wouldn't spin about. But what about covering events that are going to be massive exercises of media propaganda? Like, speaking of Paris, the UN Global Warming Conference coming up there. We've got our friend Mark Morano of Climate Depot on deck to report for us from there this time. But what about other things? Let me know. Send me an email to Ezra@therebel.media. I promise to read them all, even if I don't have a chance to write back to every email. What kind of budget should we set aside every year for trips? I mean, this was the first one we did. Would you be willing to chip in to a budget to allow us to go here or there if news broke? And if you valued our Paris coverage and want to help cover the cost of our plane tickets, please do. Please go to therebel.media/donate. Or if you think we should stay home in Canada and stick to our knitting here, let me know that too. Thanks again from all of us. It's great to be back in Canada. We'll see you tomorrow. We'll be right back.